those of you who are celebrating Father's Day today, let me extend to you a very happy Father's Day. You found, I hope, in your bulletin an insert there. This is like we did for Mother's Day. Melissa's family and my family have made a donation in honor of first the mothers in our congregation, now the fathers in our congregation. And there's information at the bottom of that if you would like to do likewise. It's a little more complicated than just clicking online. If you just go online and you give to disaster response, you'll actually be giving to UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, which helps anywhere in the world, wherever disaster strikes, wherever help is needed. If you mail a check to the conference office, it goes to the Arkansas Disaster Relief team. And that's what I did. I don't know how John and Melissa handled it, but that's what I did for Dustin and I. So your opportunity to give there as well in honor of the dads in our congregation. Our flowers today are presented to us as a gift from Leslie Crone's memorial service yesterday. And so I hope that you will enjoy their beauty. It was a beautiful service honoring a beautiful life yesterday. And so I hope that you enjoy those. Mr. John hopes that you will enjoy those as well. And then I think we have an announcement that is not in the bulletin, and that's that somebody has an 86th birthday today. Who could that be? Miss Sandra, wave your hand. And let me just tell you, I'm always honored to recognize someone's birthday from the pulpit. Some pastors don't do that. I'd love to do that. So anytime you want a birthday recognized, y'all just tell me and I'll let the words fly. If I could invite you to pass your attendance pad up and down the aisles and fill that in, that would be so great. And we'd be for sure and know that you were here today and be able to reach out to you. If you have prayer requests, you can write them in there. If you have updated information, you can write them there. If you wish to join the church, you've been visiting for a while and you'd like to write that in there, you can do that as well. And I think that's all the announcements I have. Do y'all have any? Okay. Well, welcome to worship. I'm so glad that you're here. Let us prepare our hearts for worship as the light of Christ enters the sanctuary by listening to the prelude, Immortal, Invisible. Service in prayer today. Please bow your heads with me. Gracious and mighty God, on this Father's Day, we give thanks for those among us who are walking that path of fatherhood or living into that role of father in some way or another. We give thanks for these men in our lives who are making positive difference in the world, making a positive difference in their children's lives and the lives of others. We thank you for those who are in mentor positions in life. We thank you, Lord, for fatherhood in general. What a gift it is to each of us that you are our good and mighty and loving Father. What a gift it is to us that you teach us to be good parents, good role models, good examples, good mentors. Lord, on this day that recognizes the very best of us, we ask that you would make us even better at these roles that we play in life that make such a difference in the lives of those around us. Good Lord, we pray that you would bless our time of worship. We pray that you would fill this place with your Spirit and fill each of us, Lord. We pray these things in Christ's holy name. Amen. Our opening hymn today is "This Is My Father's World." If you would stand and sing hymn number 144.
Thank you.
When you're ready, I'll just leave.
Okay. So there's a thing going around, if you watch Jimmy Fallon or anything like that, sometimes they do little spoofs on the dads. They catch them on the street and they say, let me ask you a couple questions about your kids. And the dads are like, oh yeah, I know, I can answer those. And then it always goes wah, wah when it comes to the answer time. And then the mothers have to fill in the blanks. Things like, who is your child's dentist? And things like that. And they go, oh, that's a hard question. So I just thought it would be fun to prove those dads on Jimmy Fallon wrong, right? And surely these dads know all the answers. And then we're going to ask the kiddos questions about their dads. Because why would we not ask kids questions with the microphone? Okay. Question number one. Don Chapel, what is your son's birthday?
Yeah.
July 30th.
What year is he born?
73.
73. Write that down to seal his security later. Okay. You pass the test. All right. Chris Chapel, what is Isaac's favorite meal?
Anything and everything.
Is that right?
You know?
I would say though it'd be a La Chiquita burrito steak.
Okay. Is that close? Perfect. Alright, if you'll hand the microphone to Kate, please.
Hey Melissa, I've been told we can't let Steve Morgan off the hook. His son's here too.
Oh gosh. Listen, if you want to play, come play. Okay? I'm not discriminating. Come on, Steve Morgan, if you want to come play. Okay, Kate. You'll need your son though. Or yours. Kate. What is your dad's middle name? Does he have one? Ask him. Ask him. He has one. Steven? That makes sense. Is it Steven?
Yeah.
Well, it's Steven. Steven, is it Steven? Okay. Okay. Kate, pass that to Lily. Lily? What's something your dad always says to you? You can't help.
Yes,
what did he say?
What did dad say?
When he died,
daddy. He wants to make sure it gets run through the filter before it comes out in the microphone. What's something your dad always says to you? Mr. Dustin, this is specifically from your wife. Are you ready?
Okay.
What are the first three digits of your child's social security number?
431.
Is it 431?
Nope.
Silas, what are the first three digits of your social security number? Heather, what are the first three digits of his social security number?
430.
430, okay, close. Okay.
I'm close.
It's like horseshoes and hand grenades. It's really close. Okay. Yeah. Jonathan, what is Case's shoe size?
Small.
Go on.
March, August 11th, 85.
Mr. Mark here had in school, and Carol doesn't have?
Several, I guess. Is Miss Pitts here?
Yes.
We'll go with Miss Pitts.
That's an easy answer. Okay. Would you give the microphone to Luke, please? Luke, what's something that makes your dad laugh?
Horsey.
Horsey? Oh, play the game Horsey. Okay. Okay. What is one thing that your dad does when you're not around?
Go to work.
All right. Here, this is your case. Case. What is your dad's favorite sport to watch on TV?
Their individual families.
We decided that we had to do the quintessential best dad ever mug to the winner of today's challenge, but actually they're all winners. So I'm gonna give it to the patriarch of this group up here. Mr. Donchak, you're welcome. We're gonna take a quick picture. Well, you said it, I didn't, but that's okay. So, okay, guys, you can go back to your seats. Kiddos, we're gonna head back to the room.
Thanks, Miss Melissa. Father, she did a good job. I'll just need one of those lights. Thanks. Y'all did a great job. Thanks so much for participating today. Melissa and I wanted to do something fun. Father's Day is hard sometimes for people, so we wanted to kind of do some lighter things today. I would invite you now, if I could get four ushers to come forward, we'll receive God's tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, Father of us all, Father in the good times, Father in the bad, Father every day in between, we give thanks for who you are and for how you love us. We give thanks for your words and Holy Scripture which teach us how to be good mothers, fathers, and aunts, and uncles, and sisters, and brothers. We are so grateful, Lord, that your word has instruction for us on how to live the very best life as the best disciples for you that we can be. We thank you for our fathers today, Lord. And we thank you that you are Heavenly Father. And as a sign of our worship of you, as a sign of our love for you, as a sign of our commitment to your holy church, we give our tithes and offerings. May your blessings be upon them and all of us. Our church. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you.
And that is that Silas's social security number starts with 678. I had to look it up on my phone. After I gave the question, I couldn't think of it myself. Conference, and we talked about the split in the Methodist denomination, and that was a heavy subject. Trinity Sunday, and that was a heavy Sunday too, because that's the most complex doctrine in the Christian faith, and so pretty heavy when we talk about Trinity Sunday. So this Sunday, I thought I would lighten things up a bit, and in honor of all our FUMC dads, I thought I would tell some dad jokes, but I have some helpers coming up to help me do that. The Irwin trio here, Aaron and Caroline and their cousin, Grayson, they're going to come up and help me with these dad jokes. And I know dad jokes get a bad rap because they're kind of corny and kind of silly and whatever. I love a good dad joke. My dad was a big joke teller. I love a good dad joke. So they're going to help us today. He's what?
He's a Matthew.
Oh, he's not an Irwin. Yeah. But he's one of y'all's cousins, so there you go. All right, we'll start with you. She's going to ask y'all the dad. They're going to ask you the dad joke, and I'll give the punchline. You want to hold it? Okay. What's the first one?
Why couldn't the bicycle stand up on its own?
So why couldn't the bicycle stand up on its own? It was too tired.
Oh.
Okay, pass it over.
When is a door not a door?
When is a door not a door? Ah, when it's a jar, very good. I'd explain that to Carolyn. I'm not sure she still yet gets it, but we'll get there. Okay, what's the next one?
Why can't your nose be 12 inches long?
Why can't your nose be 12 inches long?
Then it'd be a foot.
Ah, then it would be a foot, very good. A dad knows that, right? Okay, Grayson, what's yours?
What do you call a fake needle?
What do you call a fake noodle?
An imposter.
An imposter! Very good.
How does a penguin build a house?
Yeah, how does a penguin build a house? It glues it together.
What do you call a bear with no teeth?
What do you call a bear with no teeth? A gummy bear. Very good.
What's brown and sticky?
What's brown and sticky? A stick. Carol, I said you heard that one before.
What did baby corn say to the mama corn?
What did the baby corn say to the mama corn? Where's popcorn? Yeah, it took you a second to get that one. Yeah. What you got?
Where do you learn to make a banana split?
Yeah, where do you learn to make a banana split? In Sunday school. And then finally,
when does a joke become a dad joke?
When does a joke become a dad joke? When the punchline becomes apparent. Good job, kiddos. Thanks for helping out today. Thanks. You can take these and you can tell them to your friends at school. There you go. You can always use a good dad joke for an icebreaker, right? Now, I'm aware, as I'm sure we're all aware, that today is a mixed bag, right? Some dads are very much looking forward to today. They have their children by their side. They're going to be taken out to dinner. It's a celebratory, festive, wonderful, beautiful day. Other people, other dads struggle today. Other people struggle today. I myself struggle today because my dad's been gone since 08. And so on Father's Day, it's kind of a feeling. Sometimes we've lost a child. Sometimes we've lost our dad. Sometimes we didn't know our dad. Sometimes we had a hard relationship with our dad. Sometimes Father's Day and Mother's Day and other special days like it can be difficult. That's why today I don't want to so much talk about earthly fathers as I do want to talk about our Heavenly Father. Because whether we've had a good earthly father or not, whether or not our Father is alive and well, and whether we even know our earthly Father, we all have a Heavenly Father who is definitely, definitely a good, good Father. who is definitely alive and well, not in just our lives, but in our world, and who can definitely be known and loved, and who most certainly loves us. And so this morning, I want to explore three truths that we can know, trust, and believe about the deep, deep love that our Heavenly Father has for each one of us. And all dad jokes aside, this is not a laughing matter. These are three very important truths about our Heavenly Father. Ones that we can know, and I hope we do know, deep in our own hearts. Ones that I hope if we know them deep in our hearts, we're teaching them and modeling those truths about our Heavenly Father for other people. Because not everybody sees our Heavenly Father as a good, good Father. Okay, so here's the first truth about God's deep, deep love for us. One, first truth is that God delights in us. He delights in His children, all of them. Over and over again in the Scriptures, we find reference to this. It's the truth of Scripture all throughout the whole overarching narrative of Scripture, but we find pieces of Scripture here and there all throughout the books of the Bible where we learn this truth about our Heavenly Father, that He delights in each of us. Zephaniah 3:17 says, "The Lord your God is in your midst, the mighty one who saves. He will delight in you with gladness and quiet you by His love." So He will take delight in you, take pleasure in you, love to be in your midst, value and treasure you, and He will calm you, quiet you, keep you assured and comforted by His love. Psalm 18:19 says, "The Lord rescued me because He delighted in me." Psalm 147:11 says, "The Lord delights in those who revere Him and in those who hold fast to His steadfast love." And my favorite is Psalm 149:4, which says, "The Lord delights in His children. He adorns them with humble salvation." God delights in us, takes pleasure in us, enjoys us. No matter who we are, no matter where we've been, no matter what we've done, no matter what, God delights in His children because we are His creation. We are the creation of His heart, His most special creation, His children. If we believe that we delight in our children, then how much more do we believe that God delights in His children? And although that truth about the Heavenly Father may seem quite obvious to the majority, if not all of us, in this room, I assure you that this truth is not obvious to all people. So many people misunderstand the Scriptures or misinterpret the Scriptures, and they see God as wrathful and vengeful and like the policeman who's kind of hiding out, watching and waiting for you to mess up so he can get out there and nab you. A lot of people interpret God in this way. A lot of people have had such bad relationships with their earthly father or with male role models in their lives that they just can't see God as one who delights in them. I think I told y'all, maybe not too long ago, about how the funeral home had called and asked me to do a graveside service for this elderly woman. And her daughter, her son-in-law, and her grandchildren, a bunch of them were there. And I made a connection after the graveside service with this one granddaughter in particular. And she had pretty much throughout the whole service just wailed. You could tell that she was in deep, deep hurt over the loss of her grandmother. And I suspect as I got to know her a little bit better afterwards, it was because maybe her grandmother was the one person in her life who had ever shown her this kind of unconditional love that God has for each of us. She didn't have an earthly father that she knew. Some of the men in her life had been abusive to her, and she did not have this kind of view of God, that He delighted in her. In fact, after the graveside, she reached out to me on Facebook and wanted to see if she could come in for counseling. And over time, we talked back and forth on Facebook a good bit, and she once told me that she believed God hated her. Not only did He not delight in her, she believed He outright hated her. And it didn't seem that any amount of Scripture I could pour into her, or assurances I could tell her that that was not true, or as many stories as I could tell from my own personal experience of God that would prove that not to be true, it did not seem to penetrate. But it is true. God does delight in us. And as people who know that in the depths of our hearts and souls, we have to help other people find that same truth and bear it in their souls. We have to model that kind of love. We have to delight in our children, our nieces, our nephews, our cousins, our students in our classroom. We have to delight in them so that people find this experience of delight more and more often in their lives and can more and more imagine that this is true of God. I was reading a study this week. It was a social psychology study, and it was about how human beings experience delight from other people. And the study showed that children as young as our littlest ones up here and littler, when we're very, very young human beings, we already can tell when someone else takes delight in us. We read their facial expressions. We sense their delight in us and how they hold us, touch us, care for us, how they smile at us, just even in the eyes. Human beings can tell when another person delights in them. And as we get older, the study suggested, we get better and better at detecting when someone does or does not take delight in us. And the study pointed out that the more that we sense from another person that they delight in us, the more confident we are, the more self-assured we are, the more comforted we feel, and the more secure we feel. And as I thought about that this week, I thought, well, I assume that that is very true. Because I know when my parents would express their delight in who I was or something I had done or something I had achieved, it gave me this sense of wanting to stand more upright and confident. And I'm sure that that is true for so many. People who have experienced delight a lot in their life are more at ease to take risks, the study says. We're more at ease to take big steps out in faith and try something new and something challenging. In fact, it said, the study reported that experiencing the fact that other people delight in us is one of our core human needs. And so if you know, and if I know what it means to feel that someone delights in us, then we should be doing everything we can to make sure that our children, our grandchildren, our cousins, nieces, nephews, whatever, whoever is in our lives, that they experience delight from us. The more we know that other people delight in us, the more contentment we experience and the more happiness. And so it makes sense to me that the deeper in our bones we believe that God delights in us, the better, more productive lives we're going to live, the more confidence we're going to have, the more security we're going to feel in life, and the better we're going to take risks and get out there and really do something and succeed in life. So if there's one truth about our Heavenly Father that I believe all of us need to know and love and trust and believe, and one truth about our Heavenly Father that we need to make sure that other people that we know and love and care about know and trust and believe, it is that God delights in us. Here's the second truth about God's deep love for us, and that is that we are never a bother to God. Never a bother to God. And again, that might seem quite obvious to the majority of us who have a good working relationship with God. But again, this is not obvious. This is not a truth that a lot of people hold in the depths of their souls. So many people have this idea. Do you remember these movies, Bruce Almighty and Evan Almighty? Familiar with those? Where these two characters, Bruce and Evan, get to take on being God for a time and see how they fare at it versus challenging God and how God is doing at being God. Well, in Bruce Almighty, Jim Carrey sort of stands up to God and says he doesn't think he's doing a very good job. And so Morgan Freeman, who plays God, hands him the reins and says, okay, you be God for a day. And Bruce goes back home and he opens up his email and just millions and millions and millions and millions of emails are filing through, right? They're just coming in at rapid pace because it's all these prayer requests that people have. And everywhere he goes, he hears everybody's thoughts and prayers just in the chatter all around him. And he's overwhelmed by it. And I think that a lot of people probably perceive God in this way, that God is so inundated with so many prayers, the needs of so many people at all times, that he couldn't possibly care about my little prayer when I'm about to go to the doctor's office and have my throat looked at because it's hurting, right? That we think God is so busy, so overwhelmed, so taken up all this time, so taken up that he couldn't possibly care about us and our little issues. Jesus tells us that that is incorrect, an incorrect way to perceive God. And to illustrate this truth in one particular way, he tells his disciples the parable of the persistent widow. It's found in Luke 18. You know this story? The parable of the persistent widow? I'm going to read it to you sort of in a synopsis. It says, one day Jesus told his disciples a story to show them that they should always pray and never give up. Jesus told them there was a certain judge in a certain city who neither feared God nor cared about people. And there was also in that same city a woman who came to the judge repeatedly saying, give me justice in this dispute with my enemy. The judge ignored the woman for a while, but finally he said to himself, I don't fear God. I don't care about people, but this woman is driving me crazy. And so I'm going to see that she gets justice because she is wearing me out with her constant requests. And then Jesus, after telling his disciples the story, he told them, learn this lesson from the unjust judge. Even he rendered a just decision in the end. So don't you think that God will surely give justice to his chosen people who cry out to him day and night? Will he keep putting them off? No. I tell you, he will grant justice to them and grant it to them quickly. Now, what happens when we read parables like this that Jesus teaches, that Jesus tells us in the Gospels, is that we read them most often as an allegory or a metaphor. Right, we see the characters in the story, like the judge and like the persistent widow, and we think that we're supposed to draw a comparison. God is the judge, we're the widow. And so we try to look for what is the lesson that I'm supposed to learn. But the problem with interpreting this particular parable as a comparison or an allegory is that if we see God as the judge, then God doesn't care. God is uncaring. And the only reason God answers our prayer, or this judge answers her request, is because she has nagged him and nagged him and nagged him and driven him crazy. And if we compare ourselves to the persistent widow in this story, then what we learn about ourselves is that we're helpless in our own needs to get justice in our lives or to resolve our issues, and that the only way God is going to listen to us is if we nag and nag and nag and nag and nag, right? Until we finally drive him crazy and he responds. The problem with interpreting that way is because that's just all wrong. This is not how Jesus meant for this particular parable to be understood. It is not an allegory. It's not a metaphor. It is a contrast. We're supposed to look at the unjust judge and say, that is not the way God is. We're supposed to look at the persistent widow and in many ways see that we are not like her. So for the judge, for the unjust judge, he doesn't care about people. And the only reason he comes around to answer this request is because she has driven him insane, right? And he just wants to get her off his back. That is not who our God is. This is why Jesus tells them this story in an example for how to teach them how they should always pray. This is not how God is. God wants us to always pray because he is a good and loving and just Father who really, really wants us to speak to him about any little thing, a stumped toe, a friend in need, a visit to the doctor's office, a surgery, whatever it might be, God wants us to come. We are never a bother to God. And in terms of the widow, we're not helpless. When we have a need in our lives, when we have an issue that needs to be resolved, we're not helpless. We don't have to just keep nagging and nagging and nagging away at God, but does God want us to do that, or is it okay for us to? Okay for us to do that. God loves the sound of our voice because we're his children. It's like we would rather our children come to us for advice or counsel than to Google. Amen? We'd rather them come to us for that wisdom, for that advice, guidance. God would rather us come to him. We are never a bother to God. And here I would say that if we know this truth to be true in the depths of our souls, that we are never a bother to God, that God loves to hear our voice, that we should always be in prayer, no matter how big, how small, whatever, we should always persist in prayer, then we need to make sure we're teaching that to our nieces, nephews, sons, daughters, all of the people in our lives that we care about. Because again, that is just not an evident truth to third and final truth that I'll share this morning about God's deep love for us, and that is we are not alone. We are not alone. At one point in time, my sister has four children. Two are older and two are younger. And at one point in time, they lived in Missouri for a couple of years. And I was up there, I had a 2-week break from seminary. I was up in Missouri with them for a couple of weeks. And I decided on this one Saturday, we were going to get out of the house and go do something fun. Missouri is known for its caves and its cave exploration. I said one Saturday, we're just going to get out of the house. We're going to go to state parks. We're going to tour some caves. And the cave tours were going well. It was beautiful. It was a lot of stuff to take in that we had never seen. And then we came upon something that was a little scary. There was a chasm between two mountain cliff faces, if you will, of about, I would say, 7 yards. And it was about a 5-yard drop, maybe, to the bottom of this chasm. And the only way to get from this part of the cave tour to this part of the cave tour was this swinging bridge. Right, you've seen these, with the wooden planks across the bottom and the arm rail or the guardrails on the side and the handrails that are made of rope, a thick rope. And my niece, my oldest niece and nephew, I think they were about 14 and 12 at the time, super stoked to go across the bridge. They wanted to see more of the caves. They had only ever seen this kind of bridge in movies and in TV, and they were super stoked to go across this bridge. The little ones were about 3 and 4 at the time. And they were terrified to go across this bridge. And so first Taylor goes over and she gets to the other side and she's like, "Woo, together I did it." And then John goes over and he gets to the other side, "Woo, together I did it." And then the little two are a little more excited and they really want to go, but they're terrified. And Kira, the oldest of the two little ones, looks at me and says, "And Heather, will you go with us?" "And of course I'll go with you, honey. You can do this. There's lots of people on the other side. Lots of people have already made this journey. It's okay. We can do this. I'll be with you every step of the way. We can do this together." And that was all they needed to hear, that their Aunt Heather was going to be with them, and they were ready to go. And so step by step, carefully and slowly, we made our way across this bridge. And when we got to the other side, much like Big Brother, Big Sister, we let out big victory cries that we had made it to the other side. And I wish, with all that is within me, that I had a camera in that moment to video record or to capture images of what it looked like and what it felt like in my soul to be walking on this bridge that was steadily swinging with us across these 7 yards to the other side of this chasm. With them scared and yet determined, and with them taking it very slowly and very carefully, and occasionally just looking back over their shoulder to make sure Heather was still with them, I wish I could have captured this in some way, because I will never forget this image in my mind or what that felt like in my spirit to be behind them. Because it was a moment in their lives where I allowed them to take a step in faith, to take a risk, to do something they were a little unsure of, right? And yet I gave them this assurance, "I'll be right behind you. I'll be with you every step of the way." And that gave them the courage that they needed to do that. And I think there are a lot of moments in our lives that are like this, where we're about to step into something that we're unsure of, that we're a little nervous about, a little scared about, taking a big risk. And if we pause and look over our shoulder, so to speak, and reflect upon the fact that God is with us, behind us, around us, within us, we are never alone, it makes taking that step in faith so much easier. It gives us the courage we need in order to forge ahead and gain the reward we're seeking. Psalm 121, verses 1 through 3 says, "I lift up my eyes to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. He will not let our feet slip, and he who watches over us will not slumber." That's a beautiful promise and a beautiful reminder from God that we are never, ever, 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 ever alone. He will not let us slip. He will never slumber. He's with us every step of that journey, no matter how frightening it might be. And when we get to the other side, we get to celebrate the victory God has gotten us through. And the more we bear this truth in mind, the more courage we'll have to do the big things in life that we're a little weary about doing. And as people who believe, know, trust, and believe in that truth about our Heavenly Father, it is our job, our calling, to make sure that other people in our lives, nieces, nephews, daughters, sons, all of the above, that they know that truth about God. Because again, this is another one of those truths about God that to a believer may seem quite obvious, but I assure you it is not an obvious truth in most, in a lot of people's experience of God. So that's the message I have for us today on this Father's Day. A reminder that we serve a God who delights in us. To remind us that we serve a God who we are never a bother to and who always loves to hear from us. And to remind us that we serve a Heavenly Father who never leaves us alone, never forsakes us, and never lets us slip. I think the more we can know and trust and believe in these foundational truths about the God we serve, the more we can teach these truths to the other people in our lives that we care about so that they can know, trust, and believe those truths about God as well, the more we will be living the kind of relationship with God that God wants us to be living, and the more rewarded our lives will be. And the more we will experience the very deep, deep love that the Father has for us. Let us pray. Gracious Lord, we are so grateful for your deep, deep love for us. We are so very grateful, Lord, that no matter what kind of a relationship or lack thereof that we have had with an earthly father or an earthly male figure in our lives, that you are the Father we can always depend on, always look to, that's always right behind us, that we can always speak to in prayer, and who loves us and delights in us so much. Lord God, so many of us, the majority of us in this room, have a parenting role to play in this life in some way or another. Help us, Lord, to be the kind of parents and mentors, teachers, coaches, whatever it is we are, Lord, help us to be the kind of people who show others that we delight in them and that they're not a bother to us and that we love and appreciate them and that we want to hear what they have to say. We want to hear their questions and that we will always be right by their side. Help us, Lord, to be this kind of disciple, following in the footsteps of you, our Heavenly Father. We pray these things in our Savior's holy name. Amen. Our closing hymn today is Shalom to You. It's a prayer hymn. We've talked about this before. It is a prayer for peace as we leave this place, and it is a prayer for peace for one another. So as we stand and sing today, pray this shalom will fill your own spirit and that of your neighbor. Amen. Go in God's peace and may his peace.